Today, we are going to have an overview of the what's seen as the present-day leading edge of the technology and seismic exploration. And we are, as usual, focusing on the seismic data analysis and processing. Today we are going to have introduction, and hopefully we'll have afterward some more illustration about the 3D seismic data analysis or processing. Generally speaking, current day practice in seismic reflection exploration, we are no more interested in 2D profiling, but we are now interested more on 3D. As an illustration, here is the marine seismic reflection acquisition system. We have had some information about before. If you remember our discussion, we have many streams, and each streams carry number of hydrophones or transducers. So actually, every shot or every number of shots, we are collecting not 2D data, but we are collecting 3D data. And 3D data, we mean that we are collecting from data from east direction and north direction, or from X and Y direction, if we are speaking on the Cartesian coordinates. Interested until now in giving explanation for 3D case. And most of our graphs were in profile pattern, where we only have one direction, usually assigned as X, and the other one is the time or depth. This is called profiling, where the source is usually here, and the phones are spread in this manner. However, in 3D, we are not going to see this again. We are going to see like map view, where we have here is a Y direction, and here is the X direction, and the geophones are distributed according to certain scheme, and this scheme depends on many factors. These factors are the target, what is our target, and the other factors that control our design is that the capabilities we have, the technology we have. For example, here in marine, we have capabilities. We cannot cross the limits we have. We have technologic boundaries related to the ship itself and its maneuver, how it turns. So we have to take the maneuver of the ship as an example in our distribution of points where we are going to record this data. We have also limitation to the distribution of shots we have for this configuration for marine. In land, we also have limitations. We don't have limitation in putting the geophones, but we have limitation concerning the land use and the topography and other things that face us when we are planning 3D seismic experiment at certain location. For example, if you are working in an area nearby dwelling or urban areas, you are restricted. You can apply certain type of sources. You can apply certain type of techniques for recording. If you are in an area with tough topography, you also have limitations. If you have like cliffs or something, you cannot go at the same. If you are looking for regular grids, if you have like canals, like anything that faces you, you cannot move. Sometimes some activity, agriculture, sometimes army, sometimes construction also may face you. So when you are planning for the geometry, you are putting all this factor. You are putting all this factor together and always think for the optimum configuration. So our basic point is to as a scientist generally and as a geophysicist specifically, we are looking for the optimization of our work. Because generally speaking, we can make geophone interval 0.5 meters. We can make the number of geophones 1,000. We can. But this means we are going to have high cost for our work, and this high cost will be deducted from the profit we are going to have, because we cannot ignore economy in our work. Sometimes oil companies discover oil potentialities in certain places, but then it carry out feasibility study. And these feasibility studies can either direct them to invest, to exploit this potential, or to just ignore it. Okay? So one of the parameters we have is the cost. So a good geophysicist is the one who can achieve the target with the minimum cost. Because all of us can achieve, between two brackets, we can achieve the same target, but the clever one is the one who can achieve this with the lower operation and lower cost. So we have many limitations in our acquisition, in our geometry design. But first, let us discuss something about why we are migrating from 2D into 3D analysis or 3D studies. Actually, we have discussed this before. So I suppose if you remember, you can answer this question. Why we are going or moving from 2D into 3D experiments? Okay? Can the Godfather tell us? Yes. Just the volume. That's it. Okay. Maybe not Shafiq. Maybe Azrai. Do you have? Why? This is readily understood. You have 2D and you have 3D, so 3D, of course, you have more information. But why I need more information when Najmuddin? Yes.
No.
No,
easy
eye. The word easy eye, what do you mean by easy eye?
Oil.
Easy oil.
Easy hydrocarbon. We don't have easy hydrocarbon.
Easy means easy?
Easy to find.
Easy to find. Yeah. OK. Then, Adib. Yes. Then who else? Yvonne?
Because we live in 3D world, so usually we can predict better than 3D.
Again?
Because what we live in is 3D world, right? So with 3D, then we can predict better than
3D. Yes. Very impressive and excellent. Thank you. Because actually, we live in 3D world, not in 2D world. So all our objective is to obtain model of the subsurface. If you are using 2D, you are working on 2D model. You are modeling the subsurface for 2D, but it's actually not 2D. It's 3D. We are actually living in 3D world, okay? So all interaction between seismic waves and the interface is not as simple as we have just discussed in our previous lectures, but it's more complicated. Why? Because we have a change in velocity not in the Z direction only, or in X and Z direction only, but we have the change in velocity in X, Z, and Y direction. So sometimes you may have seismic energy at your 2D cross-section, and you tried all what we have learned from migration and so on, trying into their proper location. However, you will always sometime fail. Why? Because this signal belongs to other plane, not belongs to this plane. Suppose we have subsurface. Interface. Curved interface in this manner. And here is the supposed to be the Earth's surface. Thank you. Here it's supposed to have the Earth's surface. And here is your seismic line. Some energy, suppose this is the location, this is the projection of this seismic line on the interface we have. Some energy may come from these points and be recorded on my energy, on my array. They actually not belonging to my plane. They are away from my plane. So when I'm trying to migrate this energy into their proper location, I will always either fail or put the position in a wrong place. So what are the seismic data processing we are going to have, or were the current procedures that being had, that being added or carried out these days? It's the same, namely, nearly the same as 2D, but with 3D considerations. First, geometry assign, which we have discussed already. Geometry assigns, we choose the geophone intervals and separation, the mode we are distributing or sampling the 3D surface. It's not always possible to use perfect mesh. Not always possible. To put geophones at regular positions, meaning that have, say, delta x and delta y equal, or even constant delta y in the y direction and constant delta x in the x direction. Sometimes you choose to make the intervals as small as possible. When you have some information or from the wildcat exploration, that you have something in this place. For example, when hydrocarbon company acquire a concession, a place to apply exploration for hydrocarbon, adjust. Don't bring geophones and sources and go there and spread everything and start shooting and recording. This does not happen. What happened is that they first start collecting any previous regional and local studies. Then they applied cheaper geophysical methods like magnetism, geomagnetism, and gravity. And the purpose of applying geomagnetism and the gravity is to define areas with anomalies, They want to define anomalies because these anomalies are usually related to structures. These structures are possibly the traps for the hydrocarbon. You understand the meaning of hydrocarbon traps. As hydrocarbon is usually migrating from deeper depths into shallower depths. So there must be some place where this hydrocarbon, whether oil or gas, being trapped, trapped mean collected in this area, where we can just put our wells to exploit such hydrocarbon. So first, from wildcat wells, from previous analysis, from cheap geophysical methods like geomagnetism and the gravity, we define areas of interest, areas of anomalies. Then we start to apply seismic method. So we have areas of interest. We believe that we may find hydrocarbon there. So I will not distribute the geophones evenly because some areas need high coverage. Some areas, I believe there is no anomalies and the structure there is not capable of trapping oil. I will have other geophone intervals. Okay? So, in terms of the target, in terms of the environment I'm working in, I am going to assign the geometry of the analysis of the reflection experiment. Then we go for pre-processing. In pre-processing, we remove, like in assignment, we remove ground roll, static correction, and also we apply deconvolution. And you understand now that deconvolution is applied for spiking and also for removal of multiples. Then we are collecting or gathering the data in CMB, common midpoint manner. Then we apply NMO, normal move out velocity after, NMO correction after velocity analysis. And then we apply 3D DMO, deep move out correction. After all this, we are going to stack our traces in order to enhance our signal to noise ratio and also in order to have clear image of the subsurface. Then we apply 3D post-stack time and depth migration, and now I hope you understand that both time and depth migration is needed at the final stage in order to produce the desired image. As an example of the geometry, here we have marine survey geometry, as you see. Here we have the coverage we had in our first discussion. We were speaking about we have limitations. We cannot have a homogeneous one. Why? Because we have limitation. These are limitations either from the environment I'm working in or due to the technique, the technology I'm using to acquire that. So as you see here, this is an example of coverage plot for 3D marine survey. The holes we have here, the yellow one, represent areas I cannot, or I, due to the limitation, the acquisition could not acquire seismic data there. So, and every situation is changing. This this is not fixed. These holes might be in any other place, depending on the situation. For example, if you are speaking about the marine, so the vessel should have certain depths of water, the depths of water clear enough for this vessel to move. If we are going into shallow water, so the vessel can't move there, so it will change its direction to avoid such places. Maybe some places where there are some problem, maybe left ordinance from wars or something like World War II or World War I, you know, at some, is there any something wrong? Okay. But I feel you are feeling happy today. You know, and for example, in wars, sometimes mines are implemented either in submerged in water or buried in land, and you cannot go for this area and try to carry out geophysical investigation, because you are risking that the life of the personnel and also the equipment will be demolished. As an example, in Egypt, large part of the western desert was covered by landmines, and many people lost their life and lost some of their hands or legs or something due to these landmines, because at this region there were big it was a stage of big war between the German and the British at this location back in 1942, I guess. So they left this area with a large amount of mines and just go home and leave this problem to the people to deal with. So when we are going to carry geophysical investigation, we are not able to go for certain places because we know there is landmines there. Also for marine, there were also landmines, maybe some were not demolished or exploded yet. For places of conflict, these areas are marked and well known. So these gaps are not constant, depends on the environment we are working in. For example, if you are on land and you have ridge, so you cannot put geophone on ridges, so you are around this ridge, maybe you have cliffs or something, so you are avoiding such obstacles you have. Yes? Yes, Sasha? The holes? Can you see this? Can you see this? Can you see that? Okay. They cannot acquire data at these places, in this course. And I'm saying that these places are not constant. So you are not just copy this map into your memory, and then whenever you see a thing, you said, oh, this place should have no coverage, this also, and this no. It depends on the environment and obstacles you have during your acquisition of data. Okay? So to end this, we have the target, and also we have the limitations of the technology we have. Because, for example, as a geophysicist, we are also responsible partly for pointing out where is the best place to build bridges, to build hospitals, to build nuclear power plants. And also, what are the parameters needed? Generally speaking, engineer can do anything. They can build a bridge in any place. They can build hospitals in any place. They can build power plant, nuclear power plants in any place. But there will be high cost. Okay? So what you are doing is that you will provide them with suitable places so that to reduce the cost. So our job is not only to determine the subsurface, but to determine the subsurface with optimized cost. Now, for CMB sorting and the velocity analysis, here is an example of the midpoints for 3D marine survey. So here we have the X coordinate axis, and here is Y coordinate axis, and these points are the midpoints for each maneuver, for each turn, for each shooting of data. So midpoint means the point between the source, the central point between the source and the receiver. Okay? In 2D, they were aligned on single line. But in 3D, they are no longer single line. We have such distribution, and this distribution is not the same as you can see from place to place, depending on the geometry and the coverage we have. So generally speaking, now for each of these points, we are collecting trace, not in one direction, but in map directions, in two directions, that we believe coming from certain point or related to certain point is maybe you can term as CDP or the point that is related to the CMP that is the zero offset place that we are going to put the trace in. Now we have here the geophones. Okay, and the sources also is distributed around. For marine, usually the sources might be here, and then like race track, the Olympic race track, we apply. So the sources from certain direction and the points are here. So for each common mid point, we are collecting the traces that is coming from or is related to such point, meaning that if we have for as an example, not the actual situation. So suppose that the sources are distributed like that, and we have like these points, or this one as a CMB. So you are collecting geophones that is midway. Okay, now here are the sources, and here are the geophones. Let's make a small piece. So suppose we have this as a midpoint between number of sources. And number of geophones. So for this beer, usually we said, Alhamdulillah. Okay. Yarhamukum Allah. Okay. So we will collect this pair for one, and we collect this pair for another, and so on and so on, till we collect all traces that is related to this midpoint between the shots and receiver. Okay, so now the collection is not along line, rather it is area. Okay? It's now area, not like in the previous case. Like, so we have here, and here, and here, and here, and so on. So we can also define other midpoints here, resulting from the configuration we have. So in this case, we are collecting for certain point the trace that resulted from source receiver pair, where the midway is at this point. This is another plot. Here we have the coordinate of the midpoint in kilometers, 2, 2, 2.1, 2.2, 2.3, and so on. And here we have the offset, and from this we can make CDV points as you can. We choose such points for take as a CMB gather. As you see, it's not like in the 2D case, it's not uniform. We have here, we have certain shape, distribution of the points, and also here we have other distribution of the, this is another sort of representing the data. According to this, the gather itself, in the previous figure, we have one that somehow you can see homogeneous. The traces are somehow homogeneous. This is a gather that we are going to apply an NMO and so on. But this one is the second one. And you can see that the density of traces decrease here, and then we have no traces for this distance for this offset, and then we return back to have some other traces, which means that in 3D we can have different, we can have different density or different distribution of the obtained CMB gather for NMO correction, because it's not regularly spaced in 2D domain. Moreover, you can see that now we no longer speak about seismic profile, but we are now speaking about 3D block like this one. So you can see for the data a nearly or quasi 3D direction, you can see how the reflectors are doing. You can also, using the software, to make, you can make cross sections to see the distribution of these reflectors along these cross sections. And also, and this is applied after the processing sequence we discussed meaning normal move out, deep move out, normal move out, migration, stacking, migration in both depths, in both time and depths. So this produce our block diagram or block representation of our model. We can make vertical in this direction. If we assign this as Y, you can see this as in Y direction. Or if you are you want to see this, you can make cross sections here to see how the reflector change. Moreover, you can also see the final data using the so-called depth or time slide. If it is time, so it's called time slice. If it is depth migrated, this is called depth slice. So this is depth slice through 3D migrated section before and after edge detecting filtering. And the edge detecting filtering, it's type of image processing to apply to make, to define certain features. We want, we're looking for certain feature which is hidden here. We cannot define this. This could be false or something. We cannot see this here. We cannot see this structure here on the depths, in the depth slice. But after applying the edge detection image processing, we can determine. So applying 3D seismic reflection and applying 3D seismic data processing give me wealth tool and wealth information to define in more accurate way the subsurface model we have in our study area. So this ends the today's lecture about the overview of the 3D seismic. We're going to have some examples tomorrow. And the final week, next week, we are going to have idea about two or three of the most important and leading edge ideas taking place or application taking place. Of course, we are not going to speak in depth. These are the tomography and the FK and tau B back projection or radon transformation, and the seismic attributes, and specifically from these seismic attributes, we are going to discuss the AVO, which means amplitude versus offset, and this will end our course. But maybe I maybe make some additional lectures. So if you want to use, you can have it from e-learning and maybe from the open courseware. So is there any question we have? Do you have any question concerning any discussion, any comments?